All I want to do as a Java developer is to be able to access a RESTful web service. And sometimes they make that awfully complicated. Take a look at this service right here. This is a simple RESTful web service provided by OpenAI to convert text into audio. And it works fine. But you could see from the curl request here, there's only a few inputs, a model, an input, and a voice. That's all I have to send. And yet, over here you can see all the restrictions. I have to pick a model, I have to worry about the length in terms of characters, I have to pick a voice, I've got to make sure I've got the right response format, the speed has a restriction, and this is a really easy web service. There's got to be a way programmatically to enforce those restrictions so I don't have to remember them all. Of course there is. Welcome to Tales from the Jar Side. Welcome. My name is Ken Kousen, and on the Tales from the Jar Side channel, I try to give you expert advice on Java, Groovy, Kotlin, Spring, and related subjects. The goal in this particular video is to express the constraints that we have to follow in code. To do that, I want to show you four steps that represent different approaches to enforcing constraints. First, I'm going to start off with a Java record that maps to all my input values. Then, I'm going to define a handful of constants so that when I have to specify a particular string value, I've already got constants available and I don't have to worry about mistyping one. Then, I'm going to define a couple of enums for constants that really don't change very often at all. Again, this will guarantee I don't accidentally submit some invalid value. They'll all be defined inside the enum. Then comes the fun part. I'm going to show you how to use what they call a compact constructor inside a record. And compact constructors allow you to enforce validation and transformation of the input data automatically. It's kind of cool. And then finally, I'll take advantage of the annotations provided by the so-called bean validation specification to enforce all the remaining constraints that I need. The result will be a record that will automatically verify that all the input values satisfy the constraints, and that way I save myself the expense of sending a request that just winds up getting rejected. This way, I can be sure when I put in my input data that everything works properly. Take a look at this class, which I've called TTS Request, TTS for text-to-speech. This is a Java record that defines those same exact parameters that we saw in the documentation. There's a string model, a string input, a string voice, a response format, and a double representing the speed. Now, let's start with the model. The model, according to the documentation, has to be either TTS1 or TTS1HD. Let me enforce that constraint by defining constants for those. Here's my class that's going to drive the system. It's called text-to-speech service. I've already got the endpoint defined. I already have an attribute to represent my API key. Now let me define those other two properties so that I'll have them as constants when I need them. Here they are. Public, final, static strings. I'll make them public so that I can access them from outside. They're called TTS and TTSHD, and both of them have that dash one in there because that's required by the documentation. So I've got that part ready to go, and then we'll move on to the enums. The next step is to define a couple of enums, Java enumerations, that will hold only the values that are required. You could see that with voice, for example, in the original documentation, the only valid values are these six from Alloy up through Shimmer. Likewise, with response format, the only valid values are MP3, Opus, AAC, etc. And I want to define constants for those. Here's the first of my enums. I'm using response format here, and you can see that the four values I need are all defined. Now, the one thing that may stand out is this serialized name annotation. I happen to be using Google's JSON, and that annotation will let me define a name for the JSON data that's different from the one in Java. Now, they don't have an automated way in JSON of converting all uppercase to all lowercase, so I just put in the serialized name annotation for all four values. It's a little tedious, but not too bad, and I don't mind doing that. Now, let's look at voice as well. With voice, I once again put in the serialized name annotation for all six of the types so that at least in the Java code, they're all uppercase as I expect, and in the JSON data, they'll be correct. You'll notice I also added a method called random voice, and the idea of this one is that I can just ask for one of those six voices at random and see what I get. It's just for fun. That one's actually not required. Now, if I go back to the TTS request, you'll see that I did switch the voice string to the voice enum and response format to the response format enum, but I also, if you look carefully, changed from the underscores into camel case. And as it turns out, JSON does have an automated way to do that. In my JSON builder, I'm able to set what's called a field naming policy and select a built-in one called lowercase with underscores, and that'll take care of that conversion for me. I only wish there was a similar one for converting all uppercase, but so be it. We're good on the enums now, and we can go on to the next step. Now let's look at constructors. First, we'll look at a couple of overloaded constructors. And the rule in Java records is that an overloaded constructor in a record must delegate to the so-called primary or canonical constructor. And we'll do that. And then the other idea is we'll have a so-called compact constructor. Now, a compact constructor looks really funny because it's a constructor that has no parentheses on it. How weird is that? But it does intercept all of the input variables and gives you a chance to do validation and, if necessary, transformation of those values. Let's take a look at that when applied to the TTS request record. Going back into our TTS request record this time, the primary constructor is defined before the body. So that's the one that's written right after the record keyword, has the parentheses, defines all the individual properties, and we're good. And as I mentioned, the rule is for all the overloaded constructors, they must all delegate to that primary constructor. So you can see the one with three arguments here is calling this as a method with those three properties and a predefined response format and speed. Likewise, this two argument version also specifies the model, which again is one of our constants, and the one argument one specifies the model and what the heck, let's use that random voice capability as well. So those are just standard overloaded constructors. Now comes the interesting one. A compact constructor is a constructor, so you can see the name of the constructor does match the name of the record. However, it has no parentheses at all. The body actually allows you to interact with the model and the response format and any other properties you might want to deal with in the incoming record. In this case, I decided that if someone did not specify the model or the response format, I'm going to go ahead and automatically default to the TTS service for the model and the MP3 type for the response format. Now, I already have constructors that leave those out, but I could now invoke the other constructors with nulls or leave them out or what have you, and they'll get set as a default. In addition to that, here is the constraint on the speed. If the speed is less than 0.25 or greater than 4.0, those are the limits laid out in the documentation, I'm going to throw an illegal argument exception stating that fact and whatever speed was input at this point. So you see, in this case, we're doing both. We have the option of doing transformation. We change the model and the response format in case they were not there. And validation. We check the speed to make sure it's within the proper range. Next, after we do this, we'll go on and take a look at the bean validation spec. Let's talk about bean validation and the hibernate validator. Now, bean validation came out of the Hibernate project many years ago, but became a spec on its own when people realized there are a lot more things you want to validate than just the Java beans getting mapped to database tables, as we're going to see. So bean validation these days is done with annotations, and there's a spec that makes it all happen. Taking a look at the Spring initializer, this is often how a lot of people first encounter bean validation. Bean validation is one of the starters that comes with Spring Boot applications. Now, we're not using Spring in this particular application, but I just want to mention this is very common and you probably run into it there. Instead, if you go to the actual bean validation webpage, which is, believe it or not, beanvalidation.org, you can see there's a specification that changed from version 2 to version 3. And if you look at the details here, you could actually see that it's done with annotations like at not null or at email, which can be applied to getters, they can be applied to properties, they can be applied to parameters inside of methods. Now, if you go to the webpage where you want to look at the actual Hibernate validator, the implementation of the spec, they show here that you either have Hibernate validator version 7 or Hibernate validator version 8. And the funny part is the only real change between the two is they changed the packages from JavaX.validation in Hibernate 7 to Jakarta.validation in Hibernate 8. And this is largely because Oracle is a company dominated by lawyers. Yeah, we don't care. Here is the spec for the latest release version of the Hibernate validator, version 8, which is what I'm going to demonstrate for you. Let's take a look at some actual validation. This is the Gradle build file. The addition here is the Hibernate validator as the implementation of the bean validation specification. And there you see version 8. I have commented out here the actual API from Jakarta validation. That's a transitive dependency that will be brought in automatically, but I just thought I'd mention it. That is included because we included the Hibernate validator. This one down here has to do with the expression language, which I don't really care about, but by including that, you'll see in the documentation, it does make it a bit easier to set up the validation factory. So I just added it inside. Now let's go to the TTS request itself. The TTS request itself has several annotations in it now, all coming from the Jakarta.validation.constraints package. So all the different annotations we need are in that package. The model, the string that we've been dealing with, now has a pattern annotation. The pattern uses the regular expression TTS1 and then optionally -HD as well. Now we've already got constants for that, but that'll make it easier to start. This will actually validate it, and then I don't necessarily have to do any validation in the compact constructor. The input property uses both a not blank annotation to make sure that it's not empty and not null and not only white space, and a size annotation that specifies that the maximum length of the input string is 4096 characters. That could actually be it. That's really all we need. But I just thought I'd show you that on the speed one, I could put in decimal min and decimal max, and that takes as arguments the min and max value we're dealing with. Now, the problem with decimal min and decimal max is they say that the data types they are associated with are big decimal, big integer, character sequence, and byte, short, int, and long primitives. So you'll notice what isn't there is double. Which, of course, is what we're using in Java. And they say it's not supported due to rounding errors, but some providers might provide some approximate support. And we actually have some support here. But this one, again, I might want to not use here and instead stick with the compact constructor to make sure all that is working. Now let's take a look at the test class. The TTS request test has a property for this validator. The validator comes from the Jakarta.validation package, and it's created using a validator factory from the same package. In a before all block, meaning this is going to get run before any of the tests are executed, I can call the build default validator factory method on the validation class, a static method there, and do that inside a try with resources block so it all gets closed when we're done, and call get validator, which will retrieve the validator and then use that over and over again. Now, again, if you were in a Spring Boot app, you could just auto wire in a validator. There's lots of ways to do this, but since this is a simple Java app, this seemed easiest at the moment. I have many tests in here for valid ones. Here's ones that check all the model types to make sure they're valid. And here's an invalid model that should fail the validation, and so on and so on. You're welcome to take a look at the details. All of this code is in the GitHub repository and a link will be in the description. So I'm not concerned about the details here so much as the fact that we did the validation. So let me summarize and wrap everything up. What we've done is taken a class and basically encoded all of the constraints from the documentation into Java. We define some constants so that we don't have to remember which models are the valid ones. That way we don't accidentally type a string incorrectly and therefore fail in our request. We also defined a couple of enums, Java enums, which are there specifically to make sure that we don't accidentally put something in that isn't valid. So we did that for the response format and the voice. Next, we looked at compact constructors for the class, and a compact constructor allows you to do both validation and transformation of the data should we wish to do so. And finally, we saw how to distribute some of the bean validation annotations on the various properties to get the validation behavior we want. On that one, we had to actually create a validator and invoke it at the proper time. And when to do that depends on your application. In this particular case, I'm doing it in the test class, but in reality, you could do it like whenever you're going to save data in a database or whenever a service is going to be applied or on user input as a bean, whatever you like there. Now, the final thing we should do is to actually create some audio from some text. After all, we went to all this trouble to validate everything. We ought to at least use the service. Here's my test of the service. I simply instantiate the service itself directly. And in this test, I'm going to create a TTS request with some basic text in it. I'm going to invoke the generate MP3 method using that request, and I have an auto-generated file name for the output. But even better, and you can take a look at this in the project if you're interested, I have a player class that comes from an old Java project called JLayer that still works with Java that allows me to play this file programmatically. So rather than simply generate the audio file, I'm actually going to run it as well in this process. And let's see if I can get this to run.
The YouTube channel, Tales from the Jar Side, is your best source for learning about Java, Spring, and other open source technologies, especially when combined with AI tools. The companion newsletter is also a lot of fun.
And there you have it. Hopefully that will give you an idea of what you can do. And again, if you want all the code, it's in the GitHub repository. Thank you very much, and hopefully we will see you in the next video. Now, I have to mention, I have an entire playlist of AI-related videos on the Tales from the Jar Side YouTube channel, and links are available popping up right now. Take care, everybody.